Well, Linus is already unboxed the other two M1 Max on short circuit to varying reception. So here I am with the MacBook Pro 13-inch. This is completely sealed. It's even still got the little Apple tab here. You can probably tell the tone of this video is going to be a little bit different. Ooh, yeah. The thing about good packaging is that it creates a seal, you know? All right. So here's the laptop. Let's set that aside for now. Down in here, we've got, you know, the traditional Apple packet with nice Apple stickers, you know? Got the nice paper covering for our included power adapter. I think this might be the same. No, it's a 61 watt power adapter. That's USB Type-C. This is a USB Type-C cable. Of course, as with most Apple USB Type-C cables, it's probably not going to be wired for data. So on the side here, we've got a very uncourageous headphone jack, I guess headset combo jack. And on the other side, we've got the only expansion we're allowed. We've got two USB Type-C 4.0/Thunderbolt ports. USB 4.0 is basically Thunderbolt. Thunderbolt 3 is more or less an implementation of USB 4 at this point. Intel opened it up to the USB implementers forum. I think Apple will probably drop the Thunderbolt moniker at some point in the near future, but don't quote me on that. Oh, that's kind of unfortunate. I'm trying to lift it open.
Come on, Craig.
Oh, there we go. Oh, okay. I didn't do anything. I wasn't gonna power it on yet.
Because we have your sponsor.
That is true. Get the best prices and best selection at Micro Center at any of their 25 locations across the United States or online. Join the new Micro Center community to get, give, and receive advice on PC part selection or check out their custom PC builder configurator. Follow the link in the description for a free 32GB flash drive and 32GB micro SD card, valid in-store only, no purchase necessary. So once again, this is the Apple M1 equipped MacBook Pro with 8 cores, 8 GPU cores, and 16 gigs of RAM. We've also got 512 gigs of storage on here. And as for the display, it is, I think, basically the same as the MacBook Air with a slightly better backlight, which is really interesting. The differences between the MacBook Pro and the Air are evaporating quickly with the M1, with the very big exception of the fact that this thing actually has a cooler in it. With the two side by side, it's pretty obvious that the MacBook Pro is, if not a lot brighter, it's brighter. But do I really need to talk about the keyboard quality? It's the Magic Keyboard, it's fine. It feels pretty much what you would expect. Like there is basically no give whatsoever to this keyboard. The keys feel responsive and sharp. Even pressing them on the corners, it basically just goes straight down. Yeah, I've got no complaints whatsoever about this keyboard. This is the Pro. It's actually pretty thin on its own. And this is the Air, also very thin. Honestly, the wedge shape of the Pro makes the keyboard slightly more ergonomic.
You mean the Air?
Sorry, the Air. See, look, I'm doing it now. Whereas this, you're kind of resting your hands on basically a raised flat surface. Let's see, the MacBook Air we got was this one. And all we did to it was add 16 gigs of memory. So $1,449. The MacBook Pro we got, so that was $1,499 because we got the 512 gig model because for some reason 256 gigs is the standard. And that's $1,699. It kind of makes sense. I do wish they had added like, I don't know, two more CPU cores, something to differentiate it a little bit more. Oh, that sounds amazing. I know this is probably no different than the way it's been before, but the stereo imaging sounds good enough that I'm like, oh, this must be a spatial effect, but no, not really. Let's listen to the MacBook Air. So this feels like it's got a little bit more in the mids and the low end. Whereas this is a little bit more shrill, but it's not actually shrill. It's just like it's a little bit thinner, is what I mean. Very interesting. I thought they had exactly the same speakers. Maybe they do, and it's just that the deeper chassis allows it to kind of reverberate a little bit more. So what else is there to say, really? I mean, it's got the same CPU, the same guts, really, as the higher-end MacBook Air with 8 GPU cores. But even without that, it's got the 8 CPU cores anyway. So why buy the MacBook Pro? The answer, I guess, comes down to, do you like the touch bar? There's that, but there's also the cooler. And while I can't show you exactly the difference between the two of these right now, I can do that in the review. And I can tell you that the MacBook Air is totally silent because it has no fan, no moving parts whatsoever. And that actually means that it may be the more, ironically, the more long-lived computer. Because think about it, it's not sucking in dust. It doesn't have to worry about airflow. It has no way of the fan ever dying. Whereas this, it's going to suck in dust. You're gonna have to clean it out from time to time, like every other computer. The fan is obviously, it's got a service life. And it may or may not last for the nearly 10 years that mine has. On top of that, Apple is, I can confirm this much, allowing the MacBook Pro to run at its full potential for much longer than the MacBook Air. And in fact, it throttles down, in preliminary testing anyway, to about 60 degrees after a certain period of time. I need to dig a little bit deeper into that. But the MacBook Air actually seems like a pretty bulletproof computer. It's kind of weird. Whereas the Pro, it's got the same guts. You can run it harder for longer, but in burst workloads, like pretty much anything you do on the internet or even things like Photoshop or, dare I say, Final Cut, the MacBook Air should be able to handle most of that no problem. It's really weird. For the first time in a long time, the MacBook Air is just as desirable, at least to me, as the MacBook Pro. In fact, more so because it's got the top row. It doesn't have the touch bar. I really feel like I would need more for a Pro device. I feel like if Apple had given it, I don't know, like 2 more cores, that would have been the push. The performance is, again, basically the same unless you're doing long workloads, like, I don't know, compiling, video transcoding, that kind of thing. And even then, it's got the hardware transcoding engine as well. So yeah, it's a really strange time to be into the Apple ecosystem. And I'm looking forward to getting the review out to you guys. I guess that's about it. Thanks for watching Short Circuit. Maybe watch another one. Stay tuned and goodbye.